a distributed Pangea. I mean, we're all one continent once. And what is a border? A border is like someone walking into your house with a can of gas and a gun and setting the can of gas down and looking at you and saying, this is my house. And you're like, what? me and my indigenous family have lived here for centuries. Like, oh, this is our house. And colonialism says, no, no, this is my house. And if you don't want to go and like worship our deities and all those things, then like, you know, you have options. And one is the gun, which could be for you. Or the other is kick over the can of gas. I can just burn this down and you would have nothing left. And then it would be much easier for it to be mine. And I have no capital issues rebuilding it after I destroy it. That's how we created borders. What? What kind of a world do we live in where that's like where that's acceptable? And that, I mean, that's still acceptable all over the world today. It's just generally not as public. But it's nuts. And do I think that we will live in a fully borderless world? Like, that's gonna take a lot of change or a lot of time. And, you know, we'll see what happens with the effects of climate change, which could fundamentally have some massive impacts as far as creating what I would call a civilized refugee crisis. But I mean, the way that we're starting to think about living in a borderless world is actually through one of my technologies. And it is called, it's founded by Suzanne Tempelhoff, and I'm a partner in the company. It's called BitNation. And BitNation is essentially the idea of Facebook for governance, or DIY government. And we start out creating a borderless society by actually working on a human rights platform for people who have been disenfranchised. So we use blockchain technology to give refugees a global identity, a one world citizenship. And we also do all of the e-identity for the government of Estonia. So we work within systems of government who are interested in using these technologies, but in a way that fundamentally empowers every person on Earth to exist, to have the right to live, to exist, and to be, and to be recognized. So that's how we're starting this world that has the potential to at least for the time being, have more fluid borders. And in the future, I personally believe that the idea of government should be market-based. People should be able to opt in and to opt out of systems of governance in the ways that they are able to provide for their people. So governments are actually, what a concept, competing to be better, to take care of their people more than any other government. That is so deeply humanizing. And I think it's absolutely necessary if we are to live in a world that is going to have any kind of autonomous, self-governing organization. So that's our whole world is creating new holocratic systems of government. And we start by giving it to people who need it more than anyone, because those people should not be forgotten. There are so many brilliant things and incredible things that distributed ledger technology can provide for generally the benefit of our entire human race, like allowing people who are financially disenfranchised to have access to services that they would have never had before, like owning their own land titles, owning their own identity, being able to create contracts without third-party interference. And in that way, there's so much magic. I mean, giving people who live in economies where their currency is so overinflated, and that's just out of their hands and out of their control. If you live in Venezuela, for example, and the exchange rate and the amount of inflation is so high that a bag of flour costs $313, that kind of a technology, distributed ledger, Bitcoin, the internet of money, that's huge for those people. And I think, you know, the serious cons of this could be, one, that a lot of institutions who are building distributed ledger technology are building in a way that doesn't necessarily expand the way that they're looking at this technology. A lot of people are building, they're spending like millions of dollars building massive Excel spreadsheets, not actually blockchains. And I think that's a very current issue. But in the long term, if we're living in a world where all of that information is transparent or public and you're never able to delete something that you do, and all of that information is not owned by the system that is the technology, and you can't mask your identity or have your own privacy, and everything you do, every step you take is monitored and held in the hands of a public organization, that's apocalyptically threatening. And I think that we have to make sure that this technology, and honestly, based on the ethic and the ideology of which the technology is invented, it's very unlikely that it's going to be able to go in that way because of the impact, the positive benefit that it's actually going to bring to people around the world. That's genuinely scary for everyone, because it's not like you can go in and one person randomly, because they have a position of power, can edit something in or out. That's not how it works. So you have to preserve the integrity of the technology, which is that blockchain technology is borderless, it is voluntary, it is decentralized, and it is immutable. And in being immutable, it's extremely important that the technology remains pseudo-anonymous. Because let's say you're living in an area where you are under the forces of a corrupt and violent government. And let's say you are doing something to, you know, you are trying to lead a liberation. And if you are cataloging your information in a way that is going to be forever capable of being seen, and in a way that your identity is not owned by the individual, but is owned by an institution, that's terrifying. That is a dystopian future, and we cannot live in that kind of a world. So with these kind of technologies, you have to realize that we're just at the beginning of what is about to be this balloon and blossom. And this is why it is so important for people to begin to practice and to own their own autonomy in a fundamentally different way. There's not just one blockchain. And this is the beauty of the blockchain ecosystem, is that you have blockchains like the Bitcoin blockchain, which fundamentally is like the most secure. It's the original blockchain. And the Bitcoin blockchain is particularly interesting because the creator of the Bitcoin blockchain, who goes under the moniker Satoshi Nakamoto, is invisible. And so you have actually, from within the system, no general singular point of authority. You don't have a benevolent dictator in Bitcoin, because the creator, understanding the value system of what he was doing, or she, removed themselves from the project and essentially became invisible to the internet, dropped off the face of the earth. Satoshi Nakamoto has had one last little bit of communication in 2011 to tell everyone that Dorian Nakamoto, who was this innocent Japanese man that was accused of being Satoshi and all of a sudden was thrown into the media to say that Dorian Nakamoto was, you know, not actually Satoshi Nakamoto. Please stop harassing him, people from the press. And so that's actually the beauty of the Bitcoin blockchain and the way that it is not only ideologically constructed in practice, but in action from the founder. But the Bitcoin blockchain isn't the only blockchain. In fact, there are many blockchains. And there will probably be many more blockchains. And it's a healthy, robust ecosystem for a lot of these blockchains to have interoperability. For example, there is the Ethereum blockchain. And Ethereum is primarily used for smart contracts. And you essentially have people that are capable of creating apps, like in the Apple App Store, except that those apps can have their own independent crowd sale and can be independently monetized by the people who use those applications and who believe in the ideas. So essentially, instead of having a big VC funding round, someone can come in and say, I really think that doing a blockchain-based prediction market is fascinating. And it's something that has only become possible because of blockchain technology. So instead of going a venture route, I'm actually going to open up this idea, this technology that I've built on the Ethereum platform, which is a blockchain, to the community. And I'm going to allow the community to fund this idea with something like Ether, which is the currency of Ethereum. And in doing that, we not only have the money to build, but people also have the ability to become monetized as they interact on our platform and our system. And so I think the future for blockchain technology is fundamentally because you have opt-in principles. It's like, would you, if you had the choice, would you opt into a restricted internet? No. And so I think that generally people are going to move toward the ideas that inherently and fundamentally give them the most opportunity and the most freedom. But in my personal opinion, it's healthy to have this robust ecosystem of ideas where many people can create, and fundamentally, in the true nature of this technology being a market-based invention, people are able to choose. They're able to choose which blockchain provides the best services for them, what matches with their ideology, how they believe, and how they want to carry out their life. And so fundamentally, it's not necessarily, I would like to believe that the wisdom of the crowds will guide us in the right direction for this technology, because what is the value of something like this if it is not for the people participating in the system?